He calls him and he asks him to go to every imam of the masjid and every scholar of Baghdad and make them say what you say, means kalamullah makhluqa. And if they do not say it, bring them to me, I will kill them with my own sword. That now Ahmad ibn Hanbal is all alone, the one enemy of the king al-Ma'mun. The king and his sword against one scholar with his tawakkul on Allah. Just one, Ahmad ibn Hanbal. The guards asked al-Mu'tasim what to do with Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. And al-Mu'tasim said, let him rot in the prison for a few years before I see him. So now, the plan of al-Mu'tasim is not to execute Imam Ahmad, but rather to persecute him. And this is only the beginning of the trials of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, rahimahullah. So for 3 years, without trial, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal was left to rot in prison. Subhanallah, look at the zulm here. And what do you think happened when he was in prison? Everyone in Baghdad starts to visit him and tries to convince him to give up and just say, wala taqtulu anfusukum, don't kill yourselves. And his uncle, Ishaq, visited him and said that, hide your beliefs in your heart. Hide your beliefs in your heart. And he said, your friends, the scholars, your friends have already done it. So why are you so reluctant? Imam Ahmad said, Who of my friends, who of the scholars have given up? And his uncle started to mention the list of the names. This person, this scholar, and this scholar, and this scholar. Everyone has given up. And this makes Imam Ahmad very sad. And some of the names, one of the names actually made him very sad, but I do not want to go into that tangent. And Imam Ahmad held out the hand of Ishaq, his uncle. And he took him as far as the prison cell allowed, and he showed him the outside. Look outside. And what Ishaq saw was hundreds of people waiting outside the prison, many of them with paper and pen in hand. They were all waiting to listen from Ahmad ibn Hanbal a word, just a word, what Ahmad has to say, and we will spread it out, right? Like journalists, right? And Ahmad ibn Hanbal said to Ishaq, will not Allah punish me for all of those people writing down and spreading the word that Ahmad ibn Hanbal said, kalamullah makhluqa, subhanallah. If all the scholars have given up, then someone has to stand. That's what Ahmad said. Someone has to keep the truth alive. The truth cannot survive undercover. And if someone genuinely believes in this and dies in this deviant ideology, so now I have to keep this truth out in public. If I don't keep it in public, it's gone. The deen is corrupted forever, and literally forever, because the Khalifa has issued the law that everyone has to believe this, subhanallah. Do you understand the problem? One has to stand up, otherwise the deen really will be corrupted forever. And his family came to meet him. His son came to meet him. And his son isn't even wearing shoes. This is how the Khalifa was trying to emotionally break Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Before Khalifa even sees him. The Khalifa hasn't even seen Imam Ahmad yet. And finally, after 3 years, they called him to the court of Khilafah. And they grabbed the beard of Imam Ahmad and they threw him in front of al-Mu'tasim. Subhanallah, what arrogance. And al-Mu'tasim said, ya Ahmad, innaha kalima, it's just one word that I'm asking for. Imam Ahmad said, what? Prove to me that one word is from the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Prophet. As soon as al-Mu'tasim heard that, everybody, including the Khalifa himself, started to beat him until Imam Ahmad felt unconscious. And when Imam Ahmad woke up, he was still lying in the court and al-Mu'tasim was sitting right there. And al-Mu'tasim held the face of Ahmad and said, one word, just one word, innaha kalima. Prove to me it's from the Book of Allah and Sunnah of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they beat him again unconscious and put him back into the prison. This was Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. And Imam Ahmad said, this is amazing, just listen. Imam Ahmad said, a prisoner came to me and he was in prison because he was a drunk. And he said to me, ya Ahmad, if I can survive prison and beating for my love for alcohol, you can definitely survive this prison and beating for your love for Allah. This is just mind-blowing. Look at an alcohol drunkard giving advice to who? Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, rahimahullah. From what people does Allah strengthen you, subhanallah? A zani came to Imam Ahmad and said, don't worry, after the fifth lash, you won't feel it anymore. After the fifth lash, you won't feel it anymore. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. And by the way, what did Imam Ahmad do? Do you know? He started to preach and teach to the prisoners, and literally this whole prison later came out to be a bunch of scholars. Subhanallah. They didn't just become repenters. They came out of the prison as ulama and mashayikh. Some of them became muhaddis. Imam Ahmad was really something else, really something else. And once the guard brought cold water for Imam Ahmad, and Imam Ahmad said, "Where's everybody else's water?" Subhanallah. And guard says, "Mu'tasim sent this only for you." Imam Ahmad says, "I'm not drinking unless everybody else is also given equally." Subhanallah, how do you expect the prisoners will not love this person? How come the prisoners will not listen to what he has to say? They all repented and they all became ulama. This is Ahmad ibn Hanbal. This is Ahmad ibn Hanbal. And by the way, when Imam Ahmad demanded this, the guard took the water back and threw it on his face. The torture you see today is just nothing compared to what Imam Ahmad went through. They tortured him in the prison till the extent that Imam Ahmad no more could do tawarruk. You know tawarruk? Or even just sitting normally. He couldn't. They chained his legs tightly together, so it damaged his feet and he couldn't even sit properly. And subhanallah, every single Friday, this is just so emotional. This is so emotional. Just think about it. Every single Friday, every Jum'ah, he would take the ghusl and wear clean clothes and perfume himself and then go and beg the guard, "Please, this time, let me go to Jum'ah. Let me go to Jum'ah Salah." For how many years he hasn't prayed Jum'ah? And he would keep begging and crying all the time till Jum'ah Salah passes. And then he would pray the Zuhr and say to Allah, "Ya Allah, I tried but your creation didn't let me go." Allahu Akbar. This is Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. He was something else. He was something else. And then Al-Mu'tasim, his new strategy was to humiliate Imam Ahmad in public, so the people don't respect him anymore. And once Mu'tasim brought him in public to humiliate him, and Imam Ahmad said, "Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, do you permit me to speak?" And Al-Mu'tasim said, "Speak." Ahmad said, "What did Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam call for?" Mu'tasim said, "La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah." And Ahmad said, "Wa ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah, and I believe in it." And your grandfather Ibn Abbas, your grandfather, means they were the Abbasids, descendants of Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, your grandfather narrated this hadith of what is basically the hadith of the pillars of Islam. He said that, "Then why are you treating me like I'm not from this Ummah? I perform the pillars of Islam." Right? Okay, my ideology is different from yours, but I'm still one of the Ummah. Even if I am wrong, I am a part of Ummah. Why are you treating me like a kafir? Mu'tasim said, "But I just want one word from you. Just give me one word and you will be free." Imam Ahmad said, "Only if you prove that it's from the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam." Mu'tasim said to the scholars, "What do you think I should do? Should I let him go?" Nobody said anything. Mu'tasim put forward one of the evil scholars and said, "Debate Ahmad. Now debate you." I don't know how to reply to him. "Just you debate with Imam Ahmad." So he said to Imam Ahmad, "What do you say about Quran?" Imam Ahmad said, "What do you say about the knowledge of Allah? Is it also created?" The man responded, "Didn't Allah say Allah created everything? Isn't Quran a thing? If Allah created everything, Quran is also a thing." Imam Ahmad said, "But Allah said after that, everything that he created will be destroyed by the command of Allah. Do you say Quran will also be destroyed?" And he said, rather the hadith says that the Quran will be lifted before the day of judgment, right? It will be lifted from the hearts of the scholar, right? And he said, the evil scholar said, "Didn't Omar ibn al-Khattab said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala khalqa zikr, he created the zikr?" Imam Ahmad said, "No, Omar didn't say that. Omar said, anzala zikr, Allah sent down the zikr." So here you can see the example of a fabrication of hadith on the face of the greatest muhaddith alive at that time. Subhanallah. And by the way, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal made a dua. And basing upon this dua, he said to Ahmad ibn Du'at, the scholar of Mu'tazila, he said to him, "Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make the truth stand out at our janazah, at my janazah and your janazah." And this is going to be perfectly true when we come to the janazah of Imam Ahmad rahimahullah. After three debates happened, Mu'tasim said, "Now beat him publicly." And the guard said, "We are going to burn you alive." Mu'tasim said, no, do not burn him, just beat him." So they held him upside down, they hit him, they beat the bottom of his feet, they cursed him, they flogged him, and a man who was an early doctor among the public, he says, even if an elephant was beaten that way, it wouldn't survive. Subhanallah. And actually, we have reports that Imam Ahmad's skin was falling off, and he actually had surgeons had to visit him to some kind of early grafting or something. I don't know. Something had to be done about his skin, from removed from certain portions, attached to certain portions, and all. And after the 19th beating, he went unconscious for several days, maybe coma. And he woke up on 25th of Ramadan. After he woke up, he asked what happened while I fainted. And they told him that we flogged your body, we stepped on your face, subhanAllah, and stuff. And Imam Ahmad said, Alhamdulillah, I didn't feel any of it. Optimism, optimism. And they brought something to eat for him. And he said, isn't it Ramadan? I'm fasting. SubhanAllah. And now they accused him of being an extremist. And they say that in this situation, you are going to fast. This is against Islam. You are an extremist. You are not even a true Muslim. And SubhanAllah, what extremism? Look at the situation he is in. What hope he has in this situation? But Allah, if fasting is strengthening his faith, why shouldn't he fast? In this situation, what else option he has but to trust Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And look at the people who are calling him extremists, right? Who are the real extremists? One another thing I want to mention, I don't want to miss this. When Imam Ahmad was being beaten, he used to cry, Wa yaka Abu Hanifa. This is what he constantly used to say. This is what Abu Hanifa used to go through. This is what Abu Hanifa used to go through. He was being beaten, he used to recite this. Subhanallah. And he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make matters clear for this Ummah. This is going for so long, right? And then the whole story started with the dream of Imam al-Shafi, and this whole story ends with a dream of al-Mu'tasim. A dream of al-Mu'tasim. And al-Mu'tasim sees a dream, and you won't believe what he saw. You won't believe this.